Kia ora everybody, ngā mihi ki a koutou katoa. Ngau mai, haere mai ki te webinar He Waka Eke Noa, The Role of the State in Perpetuating Violence on Māori by Professor Leonie Pihama. Let's hope you're all in this right place today. Ngau mai, haere mai. And for those of you who have joined us just now for this amazing kōrero, we'll open with a karakia. Hinoi tātou. Kia hore te marino, kia whakapapa paunama te moana. Hei huarahi mā tātou i te rangi nei. Aroha atu, aroha mai, tātou i a tātou katoa. Hui e, tā eki e. Kia ora everybody, we've got a bit of housekeeping to go on with just for a moment, so just bear with me while we get through that. Ko wai au, ko Nicole Coupe tō kuingwa, taka timi te waka aura ki te mau, ko Waitangi te awa, ko kaitahu rātou, ko tiati awa, Ngāti tō Ngāti Rangitānei, ōku iwi. E mahi ana au pau whakahaere mātua o Kirikiri Roa Family Services Trust. And I'll leave Leonie to introduce herself and her wonderful whānau in a minute. Just confirming you're all in the right place. You can see He Waka Eke Noa. And we're about to go into about our community code. So here we are. Be curious, be generous, be confidential. One person, one mic. We speak from our own experience. Make space, take space. I actually can't read some of that stuff because we're hidden, but there you go. Remember, that's our code, that's our kawa, that's the way we're going to be with each other. If you'd like to chat to us, if you'd like to ask questions, you can do that by the chat, the Zoom Q&A, or I assume you can do that through WhatsApp and many other different forms that we've got available as well. Ray's giving you some clues down there as well for accessibility. Just give you a bit of time to get through that. All right, let's jump in, everybody. No mai, haere mai, Leonie. It's so nice to see you again. It's been a very long time. Just a small little story about Leonie. Pre-decol days, when I was doing science is my topic of choices, and I was graduating in my bachelor's. Leonie actually sung at my Māori graduation because my parents didn't have that capability. So ngā mihi ki a koe mō tō tautoko 30 years ago. Kia ora, Leonie, ngā mai.
Kia ora, Nicole. Tēnā koe mō tēnā whakamārama, tēnā whakamaumahara. E aku iti, e aku rahi, tēnā koutou katoa. Nau mai, hara mai whakatau mai ki rotu i tēnei o ngā huihuinga i runga i te Zoom, i tēnei wā. Hei aha, hei tautoko i ngā ahuatanga o te Tiriti o Waitangi. Tērā te tino take i tēnei wā. He mahi tēnei mai i te maunga tītohia, ko Taranaki, ko kari o i ngā maunga, ko Waitara, ko Waipawa. Ko Waikato ngā awa, ko Tiati awa, ko Taranaki, ko Waikato Tainui ngā iwi, ko Ngāti Mahanga, ko ngā Mahanga Tairi, ko Ngāti Rāhiri ngā hapū. Kei te noho au i rongi taku whenua taurikura i Waitara i te rā paki nei, i te rā mokopuna nei, he rangi mokopuna a tā tēnei. E mihi kaua e mokapuna o te maunga tītohia ki a koutou. Ka koutou maunga awa, o koutou whenua, koutou whānau hapu iwi. Huri noi te whare, tēnā koutou. Kia ora, Nicole. Yeah, it's been some time. And it's really great to hear the mahi that you're doing and kirikiri roa. And I really want to acknowledge both you and Pania for taking this time, and for the back team, right, and Fiona, who are really running the background of this hui for us all today. Also, I do want to mihi ki ngā kaiwhakahaere, whakarite I tēnei o ngā huihuinga, I ngā taui pahure, me tēnei tau hoki, and the invitation initially from Heather to participate in this particular series in terms of Tiriti-based futures and anti-racism in particular. So I wanted to share a little bit today around some of the mahi we've been doing as a team. For those of you who know, I'm located now, after many years in the kind of university system, with Tūtama Wahine o Taranaki. And Tūtama Wahine o Taranaki is a iwi social service, but primarily an iwi development and liberation service is how Tūtama Wahine describe the role that we have here in Taranaki. And so the mahi that I do now is really located within that space and within a healing space as a kairangahau. So I do premise before I do this, my role is as a researcher, as a kairangahau. And so really people like Ngā Rupi, Cameron, who I know is beaming in, and Apina and the whānau there at Tūtama, really the ones that initiate the kind of mahi that we do in the research space. So it's very much initiated out of the organisation, out of iwi need, out of hāpori need, community need. That's really been the focus of this mahi, He Waka Eke Noa. And we're just going to look at one tiny part of the work that we did, and that was really around the survey and some of the comments and sharings from whānau around their experiences of state violence. And I do want to also premise this with an acknowledgement of where we are now in Aotearoa, the impact of what is really a fundamentally very institutionally racist, structurally racist, colonially focused co-governance government that we have, and we've really been trying to, you know, acknowledge and put out there that this government and all of their anti-Tiriti basis and all of their anti-co-governance spaces and discourses, they actually are operating in a shared governance process anyway. You know, ironically, they're actually enacting the thing that they've been most critiquing around Tiriti. And so really acknowledging that in a local and national space within Aotearoa, and the backpedaling and the movement of removal that we've had in terms of really hard-fought territory and hard-fought work that many people around the motu have done in the last 50 years and in multiple spaces in terms of te reo, in terms of tikanga, mātauranga, creating Tiriti focused ways of moving and Tiriti based futures. So we do have a bit of a road ahead of us in the next 3 years, and I think that this is an important part of the conversation and work that we're doing. I also want to acknowledge what is happening in Gaza, what is happening for Indigenous relations in Palestine, and the genocidal actions of the State of Israel on Indigenous peoples in that space. So as part of where we're at and the work we've been doing, we've worked a lot with Hini Wirangi Kohu, and so Tuatahi Ake, he mihi whakamaumahara ki aia, me ana mahi, me ana tautoko, kia tātou katoa I roto I tēnei o ngā mahi, he mahi whakarau o te tangata, he mahi whakarau o te mokopuna, tamariki mokopuna, whakarau o te wahine, whakarau o te whānau. Hini Wirangi is someone that many people, I'm sure, on this kōrero today have are known, have worked with, have been supported by, have been challenged by, have been uplifted by, have been taught by, have had many acts of, many experiences of guidance and care. And so Hini Wirangi has been someone that has really driven a lot of the advisory and the advice work for us. But over and above that, she's a close friend of many, and is dearly, her loss is dearly felt around the motu. I decided to start this particular hui in a slightly different way to how we normally talk about this, and it's starting with what was developed from a previous piece of work we did, He Oranga Ngākau, looking at Māori views and approaches to what was being called trauma-informed care. And this is a piece of work that Linda Tuhiwai Smith really led out, and I worked with her on for that project. And that's a Kaupapa Māori analysis of determinants for negative outcomes, aka colonial determinants. And I wanted to start here because of this notion of state violence and kind of giving an overview of some of the ways in which this plays itself out as social and health and cultural ways that colonial determinants impact on us. So I'm just going to go quickly because I think it provides a good foundation for the He Waka Eke Noa research work. So starting with notions of historical determinants and the way in which historical colonial determinants, and these are kind of large scale, high negative impacts at population level. And these are things that we've experienced through colonization, through what we call here in Taranaki, muru raupatu. And I want to talk about that term, muru raupatu, because tomorrow is going to be the karakia for the invasion of at Te Kohia. So the beginning of the colonial wars in Aotearoa began here in Waitara. And so acknowledging that tomorrow the ahi will be lit, karakia will be done, again in memory of our tūpuna and the ongoing struggle that we have. And then the lighting of that fire and in that karakia, we also are seeking, that healing process. So notions of supra loss, so that's at a very high political level, disposition. I'm not going to go into too much depth. I'm going to give this to Fiona and the team to send out the PowerPoint. So I'm just going to quickly go through these before talking about the project. Disposition. So the term muru raupatu or muru mete raupatu in Taranaki refers to confiscation, but the term itself within Te Reo Māori takes us much deeper than that. Okay, muru raupatu and raupatu itself. Raupatu is to beat continually, to beat 100 times. Okay, so when we talk about raupatu, we're not just talking about the removal of land, we're talking about a historical trauma impact of multiple levels on our people. The constant beating and the constant patu of our people that continues every day we walk on our lands that we don't have access to. So disposition is state violence, the traumatic events that came with the many state invasions and many battles, all of those things that we experienced across all of our iwi in many and varied ways. Colonial violence, of military, economic violence, cultural, political, epistemic violence. Epistemic violence is really playing out quite significantly now with the re-attack on Te Reo Māori, on Mātauranga Māori, the diminishing of our, of the development and the pathways that we've taken to bring this back into being. And so we have multiple levels of violence that we're experiencing every day. Assimilation. So these things are not new to this audience, but I just wanted to kind of just foundation this work on, because a lot of this is what informs the kind of Kaupapa Māori analysis of the work and informs the work that is done at Tūtima Wahine o Taranaki and other institutions like Kirikiriroa, like many of you that are doing the work in terms of healing from the impact of violence. The erosion of rights, which is something that's at the very much at the forefront at the moment, the denial of access to health, so exclusionary practices, the impact historically and ongoing impact of notions of eugenic and scientific racism. So when we see a lot of the stuff happening around the denial of what it means to be Māori, we are still dealing with the ways in which eugenics and scientific ideologies or sciences of racism continue to play themselves out in social policy and legislation through this re-embedding of a notion of a hierarchy of race, and that means a hierarchy of culture, hierarchy of language, hierarchy of ways of being. The impact of patriarchy, paternalism, misogyny, which is inclusive of that of homophobia and transphobia, the ways in which they've not only impacted, but have also become embedded in much of the thinking that continues to happen and has been colonized into Māori communities. And that is something that needs a direct challenge. The pathologizing, the deficit framing, the victim framing that we get, and the separatist politics, which in a, you know, a typical structural gaslighting is put onto us, right? So we hear a lot of this from New Zealand First, we hear a lot of this from ACT, and it's emboldened and enabled by National. Okay? This notion that being Māori is separatist, when actually we know that the discourse, the ideology, and the practices of separatist policies are dominated by the dominant group, they're embedded by the dominant group. Intergenerational determinants, so the way in which state violence plays itself out within our own lives, within our own whānau, within our own hapua iwi, within our own communities, through cumulative loss, cumulative, and you know, that multiple losses. And in terms of Te Reo Māori, we have a sense of loss of it, that. In terms of tikanga, we have a sense of loss of that. That should not be confused with we lost it, because we never lost it, okay? These things have been deliberately and intentionally and consciously removed from our experiences. The loss, when we talk about this, is a sense of grief, of loss. The what whakamā does to us when we feel like we don't know enough, what whakamā does when we walk into contexts of Te Reo Māori and we feel we can't speak. That's the sense of grief and loss. Cultural assimilation, denial of Māori identity. I mean, we have the leader of the ACT Party who is a walking example embodiment of this, and David Seymour, and that whole disconnect of being ashamed of denial of Māori and actually seeking to put in ways within which people benefit from that. Economic deprivation, social cultural deprivation, so alienation. Cognitive injustice, and we may talk about this as kind of epistemic injustice. And so it is that whole notion of the constant denial of our mātauranga, of our knowledge bases, of our ways of being. And then making the kind of normative embodiment of the superiority of English. And we're seeing this daily at the moment, but it's not new. We've seen it for 200 years. But there are some areas, I think, that we began to believe that we had made some movement in, that are really being backstepped quite significantly at the moment. And food and the nutritional injustice, and this kind of, and this is poverty, right? This is the access to food, access to quality food, the access to medicines, the access to nutrition, all of those things. And there's both the denial of that, but there's also the escalation, as we say here, of things like alcohol and you know, gambling outlets within communities that do harm and are more likely to do harm. Neoliberal determinants, of course, the old trickle down, trickle up assertion that has never happened. We see this primarily in these neoliberal kind of politics that we are living with, economic politics that privilege the market over community and well-being. We see it in this ongoing assertion by the current government around landlords needing more economic support, whilst removing anything that benefits those that are in lower incomes or on benefits, removing food in schools, removing access to free prescriptions, putting more road charges on all vehicles. I mean, it's just an ongoing reversal of some fundamental things that we've been seeking to win. The punitiveness of it, and in this particular government, the punitive regimes of the state of governments, and we see that in the in terms of what is happening with the social welfare system at the moment, in terms of what is happening with this constant assertion of boot camps, with the building of more prisons. All of these are about punitive regimes of the state that we know don't work. They will never work. And so, yeah, all of this, this is really why I wanted to go through these determinants, because they're playing out now. They're playing out now in the undoing of some really important work. And so what are we going to do about this in our struggle to ensure that the work we've been doing is maintained? Okay. Diversity is masks for ongoing white privilege, and we see this quite often. People will talk in our workplaces, within institutions, about diversity, where they won't talk about te tiriti Waitangi, they won't talk about tangata whenua, tangata tiriti relationships. They will talk about diversity as this kind of multi-pluralism, that we were all the same. This is actually what is happening with this assertion by Seymour around the rewriting of what the te tiriti means as te rōranga te ratanga for all. Okay, that is exactly what this is. This is a re-instigation of white privilege under a mask of diversity and equality. Okay, being masked. All of us is being masked by these things. Cultural appropriation, of which we're very familiar with. All of this comes with increased privatization, increased move to the market, increased moral fundamentalism, that aligns and is emboldened by the state, increased white extremism and fragility. And when we think about what happened, you know, in terms of the massacre in Ōtautahi, and this now current government seeking to liberalise gun laws, this all aligns to this kind of moral fundamentalism that is coming out of a kind of Trumpism, in terms of, particularly in terms of gun lobbies here, and the extremism and the way in which white extremism plays itself out in those kind of contexts. We should not be fooled by the fact that there's a Māori woman with an act who is asserting this. What we see within both ACT and New Zealand First is this the way in which discourses of colonialism, discourses of fundamentalism can come from anybody's mouth, okay? Because that is how deeply embedded these ideologies are. And it is the discourses that we have to continue to be focusing on, and what that means in terms of the practices that are going to come to play. So when we come down to institutional and professional practice areas, and many of these things came up in the He Oranga Ngākau project, when we were talking to Māori health providers, Māori liberationists, social service providers, doing the work of healing, Nicole and her organisation, Tūtamawahine, Te Puna Oranga in Christchurch, who are a key organisation that have been a part of this mahi, are doing at the coalface. Okay, seeking to heal what the impact and the embodiment of this kind of trauma has on whānau. So institutional racism, conscious and unconscious bias. I mean, we put unconscious bias here because people use that term, but in actuality, there is no such thing. You know, you have to be sleeping to be unconscious in your education is something that in terms of the work. And so what we're having, sorry, did that pop out for a minute? All right, are we okay? Sorry. You know, this whole thing around Kaupapa Māori workforce development and having to really find resources to enable us to do that, because it's not resourced by the current state, okay? And we know why it's not resourced by the state, because it fundamentally challenges the state and its dominant power relationships. Microaggression and individual personal acts of racism that we see. Microaggression is something that comes out of the work of the University of Washington with Karina Walters and her team over there, they talk a lot about this notion of microaggressions, and those are kind of daily aggressions that at times we're not quite sure that it happened and we kind of double take on it. But actually all microaggressions are racism. When they're about a racial slur, racial act, when you jumped in the line to the next person. Those kinds of things, those daily experiences. Marginalisation of Māori providers, selective evidence-based decision-making. This government has no evidence base whatsoever. In fact, all of the evidence, even from some of the more conservative people working in the area of justice and seeking rehabilitation, are saying boot camps don't work. And there's a lot of evidence around that. And white patriarchal governance. The internalization of colonial determinants then has a significant impact. And these two things are really about how this then impacts on us. How does this impact on us? Our erasure of our own history, our erasure of memory, the way in which lateral violence within communities plays itself out. The kind of embedding or the internalization of colonial hegemony. So that hegemony where we begin to believe that actually what they're saying about us is true. The mimicry and the hyper-adoption of Pākehā and heteronormativity. And so this is about the way in which people in their own lives are really placed in a position where they just, don't have any alternative but to actually take on this kind of performative way of being normal. A lack of trust in ourselves, a lack of belief in ourselves, a lack of belief in our own institutions, a lack of belief in te reo Māori, and this has been going on for generations, and so we cannot enable what is happening at the moment to further exacerbate that. We know that te reo Māori works for us. We know that Kaupapa Māori works for us. We know that we have healing pathways. We have taken to the position now through the He Waka Eke Noa project, we're not actually pulling up with this idea of we don't know the answers, because actually we do know the answers. We actually do know the answers. We actually do have the answers. It's institutional racism, it's colonial imperialism, it's white supremacy that denies our ability to enact those answers. And then the impact of grief and how that plays out in terms of feeling aggrieved, but also that deep pōuri. And then in terms of broader social determinants, we're talking about our ongoing experiences within communities, within whānau, around trauma, around poverty, around high housing, around inequitable access, around inadequate transport, around the denial of resources to certain communities. And I know for myself, and many of the communities I've lived in, the smaller communities which have higher Māori populations in cities, are less likely to get the parks, are less likely to get the resources, are less likely to have things on hand to communities, are more likely to have a pub on every corner, are more likely to have more gambling outlets, are more likely to have more fast food outlets. So the way in which this plays itself out in terms of education, in terms of participation, in terms of access, and the limiting of opportunities that comes. If you live in a small town and you don't have good public transport, or you live on the outskirts of cities, which is where many of our people have been kind of, the gentrification of inner cities have pushed our people, many Māori Pacific people, many working class Pākehā people, and many working class communities, migrant communities on the outskirts, then of course your life opportunities and your access to fundamental resources is limited by that, by the whole structural way in which social networks are created or not created. So I did want to, because of the Kaupapa and because of where we're at, I've gone very quickly through those, but I did want to have a foundation of thinking about those before talking specifically about this particular piece of work, which is about to be published. We've done a lot of kōrero with lots of organisations and communities around it, both here and internationally. So He Waka Eke Noa, and it was developed and hosted at Tūtama Wahine o Taranaki in relation with in relationship or partnership with our other community organisation that we partner with a lot, Te Puna Oranga or Tautahi. And so I want to acknowledge Te Puna Oranga and BJ and the team. And prior to that, Tania Mataki, who was a real leader in this area in the south, in Te Waipounamu. So this is our team. And as you can see, Hini Widangi was one of the advisors, guiders and friends for the team and relations. And Bonnie, Professor Bonnie Duran, who works at the Indigenous Wellness Institute in Seattle. So when we're talking about the whakatauke He Waka Eke Noa is not one that's unknown to people. It's used quite a lot in many ways. And the reason we settled on this particular whakatauke is that it's from the definition that comes from Matuahira and Mokomid in their publication, that it's a canoe to be used without restriction. Okay. It's a canoe that can be used without restriction. So that the whakatauke or this proverb underlies the fact of community ownership. And what we wanted to do in this project is kind of explore what was happening for our whānau in terms of violence at multiple levels. And as I said, this will focus on the state violence component. State violence, community violence, and the impact of violence within whānau. Okay. So the idea of waka being without restricted points to this notion that it can be used by all, that its development, its movement, and its forward progression is a responsibility of all, okay? So it emphasizes communal use, and it emphasizes communal ownership for the progression forward, not for the state violence, but for the progression away and forward in terms of dealing with it. So it's a whakatauke that guides our people in the notions of collective ownership and responsibility to move forward. So in prefacing the state violence, I just want to make a couple of things about te ao Māori and how we understand te ao Māori tikanga and, as Nicole said, kawa, in terms of our spaces prior to this embedding of colonial ideologies on our lands. Okay, so te ao Māori was aligned pre-colonial impact with tikanga-based ways of maintaining, sustaining healthy whakapapa-based relationships. So te ao Māori is a relational, whakapapa-based way of connecting and understanding. And so when we talk about tikanga and kawa, that is related to the whakapapa of particular marae to particular hapu, to particular iwi, which is why we have a variety of ways in which we express kawa and tikanga. Whakapapa is a fundamental principle that whakapapa-based societies are about maintaining certain tikanga. People can talk about that in terms of practices, protocols, understandings, ways of being, ways of enacting, ways of being tika, ways of doing things that are correct to ensure balance and reinforce balance. Okay, so balance and well-being is central. That Indigenous people globally have actively been challenging systems of racism, systemic systems and interpersonal systems of racism, that the cumulative nature of violence that we've all experienced has had destructive impacts on Indigenous peoples around the world. And there was this idea of slow violence, and slow violence as a way of understanding cumulative ways of violence, and that is the violence that continues to happen daily over 200 years. Okay, so it's not a singular event of an act of violence, but it's a thing that we experience daily in our lives that cumulative in very violent ways. Okay. So we undertook a survey, and it was led out primarily by Shirley Simmons, and we had some great kōrero around how we wanted to do this. And for those of you who are familiar in terms of Māori health frameworks, you can see that we've utilised this framework in terms of whānau order, Māori order, wai order and pai order. Today I'm just going to look at the whānau order. And whānau order was constructed and developed by the team around collective experience of violence. Okay, so have you or your whānau experienced these collective experiences of violence? And so it focused on notions of state violence, neglect, failure to protect, abuse of power, breaches of Tiriti, racism, police violence, and media violence. Now, because of the time, I am not going to get a time to read all of the quotes, but I just wanted to put some quotes up in terms of the qualitative or the kōrero, whakawhiti kōrero part of the project, where our people talked about, when we asked them about kind of sources of violence within communities, would talk consistently about confiscation. Confiscation of land and pene raupatu, the confiscation by the pen, the way in which policy, legislation, acts, confiscation by the pen removed millions of acres of our land. We've all had this experience with our own whānau up on iwi, where it's actually been legislated away from us. And the most recent was the Takutai Moana legislated away in 2005, 2006. So it's not only a 200-year experience, but it's a relatively recent experience. Origins of whānau, coming out of colonialism, coming out of the way in which all those determinants have come to play on us, and how they have then become a part of the interrelationships that we are having within our own whānau hapū and iwi. Not all whānau hapū and iwi, but for some, that level of disconnect and that fire, the impact of all of those multiple determinants play out in certain ways. So this one is around, have you experienced racism from the state? And you can see here that only 16.6% of those surveyed, and there were about, I don't have the exact figures here, there were around 1,600 people, okay? So, around that overall. So, but the majority said they had experienced racism from government agencies, some a few times, some a lot. Okay, so we are looking, you know, within this, over 80% have experienced racism in government, in their or their whānau. And you can see on the side, we've just picked five of the organisations, but there are others, but these kind of were the top five: Education House, Police, WINZ, and the Justice System. So the state of structural racism was also commented on in the whakawhiti kōrero, the interviews and the discussions that we have. And you can see here, you know, it's very clear. People are very clear about living in a racist society, and they're bullheaded to fuck. And it is. That is the impact of this on our people. The next is, have you experienced neglect? Have you or your whānau experienced neglect by the state? Denial of access to social services from the state or from government agencies? And again, we have 67-odd% saying they have, okay, with only 32% saying they hadn't. The main culprits institutionally being health, WINZ, education, police, and justice. So, you know, this pairing back of Te Aka Whai Ora, of the removal of this, the Māori House Coalition, you know, goes against all of the evidence that our people give us and have shared with us for many years around the neglect that they've experienced, the racism that they've experienced, the failure to care, the failure for fundamental duty of care in these institutions, and not only the failure, but layered on top with racism, layered on top with institutional structural impediments. In your lifetime, have your whānau experienced a failure to protect from state or government agencies? Again, 65% have. And leading the culprits in this one are the police. Okay. Police, health, justice, education, WINZ. Now, some people have asked us, why are we not seeing the Ministry for Children appear in this? And the reason for that is because in order to experience this, you had to have actually been directly engaged with these institutions, okay? And so in the numbers, we know where the vast majority of children in state removal are Māori. It doesn't mean that every whānau has had an experience with that organisation. But you can see here a failure to protect again. And this particular discussion in the in the whakawhiti kōrero process that we did in the qualitative part of the research. You know, people can name these things, right? We can name the police system. We can name the court system, the justice system. We can name that certain people, in particular that Pākehā within the system, are more able to negotiate a system. They are less likely to be picked up. They are, you know, more Māori are more likely to be picked up walking brown, as Moana Jay would say, more likely to be put in through the front of the court system, more likely to be convicted, more likely to be given a higher sentence, more likely to be incarcerated. So we know that it goes through every single part of the system. It is not an isolated site. In your lifetime, have you or your whānau experienced abuse or abuse of power from the state or from government agencies? 72% of the whānau that answered this question believes that, you know, have experienced some form of abuse or abuse of power. Again, the police, health, justice system, education, and this is where Oranga Tamariki begins to play. The abuse of power, and often an experience with the ministry, because, you know, where this pulling back of te reo Māori in the state sector is highly problematic, Oranga Tamariki should not have that name. Okay. They should not have that name, because that name, as we know, brings forward notions of healing and well-being for our tamariki. And every single report that comes out of that place, no matter who is leading it, shows that the structure is so embedded with racism that it is never going to change. And the well-being of our tamariki and mokopuna need to come back to hapu, whānau, hapu, iwi, and to these Māori health organisations that can mediate and negotiate these spaces. Why? Because we know our people. Because we know our people. So, again, at a state level, at a community level, the personal level, you know, violence occurs. So violence occurs when Māori are walking down the street. Violence occurs when Māori boys are walking up the street and other ones pulled over by police. This is not uncommon. And that's why, you know, I made mention of Moana Jay's kōrero, you know, being arrested while walking brown. And he had many stories where he gave examples of that being the case. This one, on a personal level, when I have a really great articulate academic sentence come out of my mouth and the response that they get is, oh, this Māori is clever. You know, so it happens in a daily way. In your lifetime, have you or your whānau experienced breaches of te tiriti o Waitangi from the state or government agencies? 83%. 83% of our people experience and whānau have experienced breaches of te tiriti o Waitangi. So this mythology that people do not understand what te tiriti o Waitangi guaranteed us, this mythology that people do not understand the relationship between rangatiratanga and kāwanatanga is entirely a mythology. We're talking about 83% of people engaged in this particular mahi could clearly state that for their whānau that was an experience. And the interesting about this is that we see it playing out. So the other institutions appeared, but actually we see now coming to the fore places like customs and immigration. And we've got to think, how does that come to the fore? Well, because many of us who look like me, who walk through customs, who happen to be the random Māori woman with a moko pulled over every time. In fact, one of my sons said to me going through again a few years ago, said to me, oh, you're the random one again, you know? And those are spaces that to challenge that has serious consequences. You know, district and regional councils, and we know RMA, we know the land, we know here in Waitara, the block that I sit on, that our whānau land, that we sit on, is the Pika Pika block. It's Te Ate Awa Iwi land, it's Manu Kōrihi Otarawa Hapu land, our Hapu land borders on Waitara Ngāti Rahiri. We're sitting on the Pika Pika block. Our family had to raise the money to buy back the lease of the land that they had stolen, because a few years ago the council decided that they would freehold it, what they called endowed land. Now, endowment land is land that's been gifted. This was not endowment land. It was stolen land. And if you know the history of the Pika Pika block, and you know the history of the mahi of our tupuna tomorrow, that's going to happen. Te rau mahi is how it's often referred to. If we understand that, and we know that district and regional councils have control over millions of acres of land, stolen land. So I'm not going to continue on that, because I could do that for the rest of the day. The Department of Conservation, again, so we see Tiriti Waitangi playing out in different ways, okay? The obvious ones around education, justice, health, all of those, we know those ones. But often other ones are more insidious, and they play out at levels in whānau and hapū and these kind of battles, battles around their whenua and access to their whenua. So we're coming near the end, and I want to just whip through these last two. State violence, there's no adherence to Te Tiriti o Waitangi. And in this one, the Ministry of Children, Family Courts, Prisons, Courts, the government itself. What we're having now with this expediency through using urgency to basically fuck over the country in 100 days, even in their own governmental and dominant Pākehā Western frames of democracy, it is not acceptable. And I'm not going to say excuse my language, because that's what they're doing. They're fucking us over. State violence. In your lifetime, have you experienced police violence? Okay. So, and again, this requires a direct engagement with the police. And many of the whānau that talked about this talked about actually that they avoid the police. They do everything they possibly can to avoid the police. So many of those that have never experienced this have done it through their own systems of ensuring that they don't get engaged by the police. But 52% have experienced direct police violence. So I'm going to jump over this one here and come to the impact on wellbeing. The impact of wellbeing of state and systemic violence on our people, 81% of our people indicate that it has a direct impact. It has an impact on our wellbeing. So when we're engaged with this, it's not only happening at a kind of structural level, but at an interpersonal level, it has a huge impact. And I just wanted to close with these comments, which are the comments that are coming out in the upcoming report, He Waka Eke Noa, and the closing comments are around tino danga tiritanga. And that is around, and that's what I see the series as being about, reaffirming the need of honouring Te Tiriti o Waitangi. They're the next tino danga tiritanga, they're the next mana motu haki for Māori. And that's reiterated in this particular kaupapa. There must be a dismantling of the existing colonial systems and institutions that create an environment within which violence is not only perpetuated, but in relation to a number of state institutions is reproduced. The denial of fundamental rights of self-determination is an act of state violence. It's argued that systemic violence, systemic change is required, and that necessitates constitutional reform. This is not only a means by which to honour Te Tiriti o Waitangi, but it's also a process of decolonisation and gives a pathway for the reconstitution of systems that affirm te reo, tikanga, māturanga, and embeds a meaningful rangatiratanga, kāwanatanga relationship. Nō reira, kia koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, huri noa te whare, tēnā tātou tātou.
Oh, kia ora, Leonie. Ngā mahi ki a koe mō tō authenticity. Hey, awesome.
Kōrero, and I think anyone, any Māori in this rōpū listening to you would be experiencing some of those microaggressions every day, but I think they're turning more macro lately and more open and more in your face. Thank you, Mr. Trump. I'm just opening up the floor to either questions within the webinar chat or within the Q&A. If anybody wants to post there, that would be fantastic. Just give them a minute. They're all saying how wonderful your kōrero was, e hoa. So you're living home. Isn't that awesome?
Yes, it is. It's awesome.
It is awesome.
Yeah.
So I'm going to ask you one while we wait for others to think about how, you know, their wonderful pātai. And this work that you're doing is home, that you've started that mahi? You're doing all that mahi?
Yeah. So Tita Mohi is Taranaki, is here in Taranaki and is now locating into Waitara, which is a really amazing relocation for the organisation. And so the mahi, this mahi, as I said, comes out of the pātai and the whakaaro out of Māori, you know, Māori health providers, iwi health providers and iwi liberation organisations like Tūtama. So
pretty standard. I think it's, you could, you know, generalize that across most of our communities that are working in all those sectors. So thank you for actually giving that to us to actually use in our responses to some of the work we're doing. You've got a question from Joy at Joy Tautohi. I should have put my glasses on. What are some of the ways we can respond to deliberate acts of racism / violence microaggression within professional settings, i.e. health and wellbeing and clinical settings within a tertiary education system?
Well, I mean, the way that I respond is generally pretty directly. But, you know, people have to, for one, I think it's really important to have tautoko, particularly if you're in a Pākehā institution or a government institution where the potential for you to be isolated is real, you know, let alone the other potential implications of raising issues of racism. And for those of you who are aware of what happened at the University of Waikato a couple of years ago, you know, a number of scholars that raised those issues, all of which have now left the University of Waikato. And so, you know, that's the impact of bringing up things structurally. So I think it is around on a daily level, making people more aware of what they're doing, more conscious of what they're doing, speaking directly back to it. And for others, it's really around bringing forward these tikanga ways of doing things in their own institutions and continuing to do that irrespective. But I've, you know, it's been very, my experience is that if we don't find a way as Māori to challenge these and to lay down that challenge for change, you know, it won't happen. You know, find allies in your institution, find allies in your organisation, talk to other people that you're working with, and do it. I am an advocate for people trying to do things collectively rather than individuals having to carry the entire weight. But I do know that sometimes that's not able to be done.
Dirk is asking, how can a constitutional reform look like and what does it include?
Well, I mean, there's a huge report that's been done around constitutional reform, and I think that there's a webinar on that, but it does include and necessitate a dismantling of the existing systems that we have. It requires a shifting back to a fundamental rangatiratanga, kawanatanga relationship. And within a kaupapa Māori space, what we're always talking about is this whole way of not being subsumed under other things, but actually, that's what Tiaka Whaiora was. I mean, actually, Tiaka Whaiora was a good example of how we can begin, and so it may not be the perfect example, but it was a really great example of how working together, we can work out these systems that actually challenge some of the fundamental colonial ways that systems operate. But we are talking about a rangatira kāwanatanga way of governing in this country, which is what was guaranteed, what was agreed to in Te Tiriti o Waitangi. You know, so there is a rangatiratanga house and there is a kāwanatanga house. We all then work together for the betterment of all, but there is an affirmation and acknowledgement of all that, and that has to be embedded through all the structures. Also, constitutional change that will actually be based within Te Tiriti o Waitangi. In my view, as we've always argued, that things for Māori, when we're looking at transformation, actually bring a betterment for all people living on this land.
Aye, total koehua. Lynette Wharerau, in terms of rangahau, is there any correlational or corresponding responses between rural and urban communities and pre or post treaty settlement based?
That's interesting. That's a really interesting question. We've got, within the survey, we do have geographic material in terms of the demography. And so, and I think that people have done stuff in rural communities and have done stuff in urban communities. And so it's a matter of looking at those. In terms of that, that would require breaking that down. And when we did the survey, it was during COVID. And so it was really, a lot came down to people's accessibility as well, which we know is also problematic. Off the top of my head, I'm trying to think if there are specific. If we go into things like te kupinga, which also has a lot of stuff around access to knowledge, Māori knowledge, there's they have breakdowns by region because they have the numbers to do that. The pre and post settlement information is, I mean, that's another area. I think that most hapu and iwi have not collected their own data pre. Some are looking to collect data because you've got to have resources to collect that data. And it comes down to what are the questions that we want to ask. I think that there are a number of iwi, I don't like post-settlement governance entities as a process. It's something that iwi are forced into in that negotiating process. So the thief steals the land, tells you when they're going to give it back, what they're going to give it back, what it's valued, and then how you have to economically frame it. So I think PSG is a problematic anyway, but I think that that's an area that this mahi is the tip of an iceberg. Every hapu, every iwi, every whānau, every community really needs to be doing this. And the other thing is that the historical trauma literature coming out of the work of Karina and Tessa Campbell, Bonnie Duran, Michelle Johnson Jennings, those researchers on Turtle Island, you know, they say that different historical experiences will lend themselves to different outcomes, right? So layers of evasion, and I mean, you all know that working in the social service field, you know, those consequences are not necessarily always the same or identical.
Awesome. We've actually run out of time, so I'm going to run through the end, but ngā mihi ki a koe, Leonie. Thank you so much for your efforts and time and the work you're doing at home that we can now, you know, tahai it and use it in our own spaces as well. I really appreciate that. I'd like to also thank the volunteers and partners who have helped bring this event to life. And we've got a massive picture of all those logos coming up. 35 organisations have been backing this event. Just a reminder that we would like you to come and join Kei Te Muda o Te Aha, a marathon for rural justice on Friday, the 22nd of March, and it's running all day. Just drop in during that time. And most of these recordings, I assume, I'm looking for nods, are going to be up on YouTube, including this one, which will be very useful, those statistics. Yep, I'm looking, yep, that including this one. Thank you all for attending midway through your Saturday. For some of us, it's a beautiful day outside, but we're doing some learning instead. It's nice to see you, Di, and a few other people that are, and Maria, that are on the webinar today. So I'm just going to close this off with a closing karakia. Let me think. Unuhia, unuhia, unuhia ki te uru tapunui. Kia wātia, kia mama, te ngākau, te tinana, te wairua, i te ara, takata koera e rongo, whakaerea ki te rongo, kia tina, tina, haumie, huie, hae ki e, kau, hae ki te koutou, ngā mahi ki a koutou katoa.